Good morning, church. We want to welcome you to North Fairfield's Sunday morning worship. And we're excited to kick off a new series for the month of May called We Cry Out, where Pastor Matt will lead us through the Old Testament book of Lamentations. So we want to invite you right now to go ahead and look up Lamentations chapter 1 in your Bible, or if you're following along on a Bible app or the YouVersion app, go ahead and grab Lamentations chapter 1 right now, as we'll be reading passages from that first chapter throughout our worship this morning. So go ahead and look that up right now. But we're excited as Pastor Matt will lead us through that Old Testament book. And lamentation means a passionate expression of grief or sorrow. It's not just a crying, but a wailing, a sobbing. And we'll see as God's people cried out in despair to God for their circumstances, for their situation, even for their sin. And we'll be able to recognize, as we find ourselves in a unique situation during this time, that God wants us to cry out to Him in our need. So again, we're excited to kick this series off. So go ahead and grab Lamentations chapter 1 as we begin this morning with Bernie reading the first section of that chapter for us.
Lamentations chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. How she sits alone, the city once crowded with people. She who was great among the nations has become like a widow. The princess among the provinces has been put to forced labor. She weeps bitterly during the night, with tears on her cheeks. There is no one to offer her comfort, not one from all her lovers. All her friends have betrayed her. They have become her enemies. Judah has gone into exile, following affliction and harsh slavery. She lives among the nations, but finds no place to rest. All her pursuers have overtaken her in narrow places. The roads to Zion mourn, for no one comes to the appointed festivals. All her gates are deserted. Her priests groan, her young women grieve, and she herself is bitter. Her adversaries have become her masters. Her enemies are at ease, for the Lord has made her suffer because of her many transgressions. Her children have gone away as captives before the adversary. All the splendor has vanished from daughter Zion. Her leaders are like stags that find no pasture. They stumble away exhausted before the hunter. During the days of her affliction and homelessness, Jerusalem remembers all her precious belongings that were hers in the days of old. When her people fell into the adversary's hand, she had no one to help. The adversaries looked at her, laughing over her downfall. Jerusalem has sinned grievously. Therefore, she has become an object of scorn. All who honored her now despise her, for they have seen her nakedness. She herself groans and turns away. Her uncleanness stains her skirts. She never considered her end. Her downfall was astonishing. There was no one to comfort her.
Draws me to your side. Lamentations 1:9-18 says, Lord, look on my affliction, for the enemy triumphs. The adversary has seized all her precious belongings. She has even seen the nations enter her sanctuary, those you had forbidden to enter your assembly. All her people groan while they search for bread. They have traded their precious belongings for food in order to stay alive. Lord, look and see how I have become despised. Is this nothing to you, all you who pass by? Look and see. Is there any pain like mine, which was dealt out to me, which the Lord made me suffer on the day of his burning anger? He sent fire from on high into my bones. He made it descend. He spread a net for my feet and turned me back. He made me desolate, sick all day long. My transgressions have been formed into a yoke, fastened together by his hand. They have been placed on my neck, and the Lord has broken my strength. He has handed me over to those I cannot withstand. The Lord has rejected all the mighty men within me. He has summoned an army against me to crush my young warriors. The Lord has trampled virgin daughter Judah like grapes in a winepress. I weep because of these things. My eyes flow with tears, for there is no one nearby to comfort me, no one to keep me alive. My children are desolate because the enemy has prevailed. Zion stretches out her hands. There is no one to comfort her. The Lord has issued a decree against Jacob that his neighbors should be his adversaries. Jerusalem has become something impure among them. The Lord is in the right, for I have rebelled against his command.
And it is well, it is well. with me.
It says in Lamentations 1, "Listen, all you people, look at my pain. My young women and young men have gone into captivity. I called to my lovers, but they betrayed me. My priests and elders perished in the city while searching for food to keep themselves alive. Lord, see how I'm in distress. I am churning within. My heart is broken, for I have been very rebellious. Outside, the sword takes the children. Inside, there is death. People have heard me groaning, but there is no one to comfort me. All my enemies have heard of my misfortune. They are glad that you have caused it. Bring on the day that you have announced, so that they may become like me. Let all their wickedness come before you and deal with them as you have dealt with me because of all of my transgressions. For my groans are many and I am sick at heart."
For my groans are many and I am sick at heart. And those last words of Lamentations chapter 1, those last words that Eliana just read, really echo what's in a lot of our hearts at this time. Our groans are many and I am sick at heart. We're groaning about a lot of different things. Groaning over the loss of loved ones, groaning over loss of jobs, groaning over a loss of normalcy, groaning over a loss of relationships, and loss of proximity, loss of proms, and a loss of graduations, a loss of vacation, loss of sports and sporting events. And there's so much that we have lost and so much that we can grieve over. And one of the beautiful things about Scripture is that it doesn't paint the human experience, the experience of man, as something that is just sunshine and rainbows all the time. It doesn't paint the human experience as perfection. If you just live for God and love God, everything is going to be perfect. No, in God's Word, we have books like Lamentations, which document the pain and suffering of the people of God, but doesn't just talk about their pain and suffering, but it teaches us how to respond in pain and suffering by showing how they rightly responded. So what we read in Lamentations chapter 1 was read for us. And what we'll be studying for these next 5 weeks in Lamentations is what is called a lament. A lament is a crying out to God in honesty and faith. In Lamentations, we have a response of the people of God following the destruction of the southern kingdom of Judah. After the destruction of Jerusalem around 587 or 586 BC. And so the city of Jerusalem was besieged by the Babylonians for 3 years. Those who lived in the city nearly starved to death as a result of the siege. And then finally, when the walls were destroyed, there was just severe calamity and pain and destructions. Those who survived the siege, those who survived the fall, those who survived the attack became prisoners and exiles and slaves. I mean, this is a painful, painful moment in the history of Israel. And we know it is painful because immediately after it was written, Lamentations is written. And it is used by the people of God to mourn as a group the events that unfolded. But not just to mourn. They were honest about what happened, but not just honest. They're also used to turn them back to God. Because that's what a lament is. A lament is honesty about what has happened. Honesty about the grief and the pain and the suffering. Honesty about the groaning and the sickness of heart. But done in faith and a holy, loving, good God. So the people respond. They respond by coming together to lament together. And in so doing, they teach us how to lament. Now in Psalms, we have a large number of laments. In Psalms, we have about a third of the 150 different chapters either include laments or are in totality a lament itself. That's the largest category of any type of psalm that there is. And so it's clear that God is concerned with our ability to properly process and respond to grief and pain and suffering. And God is concerned because we're really bad at it. I mean, our responses to grief and pain and suffering, our reflex, our habit is often bad. Whether it be turning to outside substances to numb the pain, turning to bitterness or anger or resentment, turning to food or drink, or just turning to despair and turning inward and forgetting everything around us. Like, we respond poorly to grief and pain and suffering regularly. And so God wants us to learn from the laments in Scripture and to learn from His Word how to properly respond when everything goes bad. Because here's what's true for all of our lives. At some point, your groans will be many and you will be sick at heart. At some point, you'll be at a time of grief and despair and suffering. And in that moment, you're going to need to lament. You're going to need to cry out to God in honesty and in faith. So over these next 5 weeks, we're going to study this book of Lamentations and to see what God has to say to us about learning to cry out to Him in the midst of pain, in the midst of grief, in the midst of suffering. The first thing we'll see here in chapter 1 of Lamentations is that we need to cry out to God in the midst of our pain. Cry out to God in your pain. Notice in verse 1, how she sits alone, the city once crowded with people. She who was great among the nations has become like a widow. The princess among the provinces has been put to forced labor. Again, I said that this is written shortly after the siege and destruction of Jerusalem. Shortly after also includes the fact that the pain wasn't over with. This isn't written hundreds of years later, in which everything has been brought together, the people are back in the city, and things are well. They are writing to God, responding to God, speaking to God, praying to God in the midst of their pain. This opening line, I mean, that's a haunting thing. How she sits alone. It is current. It is present. It is painful. Now, to pray in the midst of pain, it is difficult. It is painful. It is a struggle. And the unfortunate reality is, for many of us, turning to God in the midst of pain is not the first thing that we do. And we'll turn a lot of places in the midst of pain. We'll turn to other people. We'll turn to ourselves. We'll turn to businesses, to busyness. We'll turn to bitterness. We'll turn to counselors and countless others, but for many of us, turning to God is not the first thing that we do. It seems so simple, though, right? Like, it seems simple for us to think outside of the moment, yes, the first thing that I should do in the midst of pain is to turn to God. But we all know that in the midst of pain, it's so often not the case. See, there's something important for us to understand about lamenting, about crying out to God in our pain, is that it takes faith. Like, it takes faith to believe that God hears and God knows and God is concerned with what is happening in our lives. Like, it takes faith to pray, and for us to not pray in the midst of that moment, it's not just disobedience, it's a severe lack of faith. shows that we don't believe that God is good. We don't believe that he hears. We don't believe that it'll do anything. You see, God calls us in Philippians to not be anxious about anything, but in everything to present our requests to the Lord. What he's saying to us in that passage is that we need to stop talking to ourselves about our problems and stop talking to other people about our problems, but start talking to God about them. In the midst of your pain, the first thing that you should do, first thing that we should all do, is turn to God. And this is what the author of Lamentation does. Shortly after the pain, in the midst of the pain, in the midst of the suffering, while things are still destroyed all around, he writes these words, but he doesn't just write in the midst of pain. He also writes about the pain. So we cry out to God in the midst of our pain. We cry out to God in our pain, but we also cry out to God with our pain. And one thing that is true of Lamentations is brutally honest. And God is calling us to be honest with what is grieving us and what is paining us and what we are upset about. Notice in verses 1 through 12, this repetition of the word all. All her gates are deserted. All the splendor has vanished in verse 6. All who honored her are now despised her in verse 8. In verse 11, all her people groan. When the author of Lamentations is clear, this is total devastation. He is clear and honest and forthright. And what we need to understand is that God can handle your grief. God can handle your honesty. God can handle you being frank about what is impacting you and causing you grief and causing you pain and causing you trials and suffering and discomfort. God can handle it. There's a book by a pastor named Mark Rogop, and the book is called Dark Clouds, Deep Mercy, and it's a book about lamenting and learning to lament and teaching us this lost art of lamenting. And he's a pastor, and one of the things that he had his staff do was come together, and in the midst of this prayer time they were having as a staff, he wanted them the freedom to offer up a lament, to be honest to God about their problems and their grief and their pain and their suffering. So there's a little bit of period of awkward silence in the room, and finally one of the women got up and sat in the seat in the middle of the circle. She starts weeping, and the others come around her and begin to comfort her. And she pulls a little note card out, and then she reads this: "How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you withhold the blessing of a child from us? How long will we cry to you? How many more days, months, or years will pass with our arms remaining empty? How much longer will we struggle to rejoice with those who rejoice while we sit weeping? But I have trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me." Notice there's a massive shift, but this lament begins with honesty. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? Will you withhold the blessing of a child from us? That's personal and honest and intimate and frank. How long will we cry to you? How many more days or months or years? This is not new pain or new grief or new sorrow. How much longer will we struggle to rejoice with those who rejoice while we sit weeping? And one of the beautiful things about God and about lamenting and about being honest with our pain is that God isn't waiting around for us, and God isn't requiring us to decide if our grief is worthy. God is calling us in the midst of our pain just to be honest about what is grieving us. God wants your honesty. God loves you, and he understands and he sees you, and he knows that you are grieving and in pain. It does you no good to feign something that is not true, It does you no good to act and to try to talk to God like things aren't real. Be honest, be forthright, be frank. And we should lament together, be honest about the things that we're grieving over. Lament the thousands upon thousands that are dead because of this disease. Lament the sick. Lament the countless millions at this point. The millions of people who are without a job. So we should lament that and grieve that. Lament the loss of graduations, the loss of proms. Like, grieve those things and be honest to God about those things. God isn't judging what is grieving you. He is calling on you as a loving father to be honest with him about what is grieving you. Lamenting is honest and clear. And in Lamentations, there is honesty about what is going on. Honesty about all her friends are betrayed, all who honored her despised her. Honesty about all the things that have gone down. But he's not just honest about what has happened. There's also an honesty about who did it. See, in Lamentations, it is clear that the author understands that this calamity is the result of the people's sin and God's judgment. Beginning in verse 12, says this, "Is there any pain like mine, which was dealt out to me, which the Lord made me suffer on the day of his burning anger?" Verse 13, "He sent fire from on high. He spread a net. He made me desolate." Verse 14, "He has handed me over." 15, "The Lord has rejected. He has summoned. The Lord has trampled." Over and over and over, Lamentations is clear that God has done this, and he has done it because of the sinfulness of the people. That their pain and their grief and their sorrow is the result of their sinfulness. See, there's a lot of times in which God will not cause us to bear the weight of our sinfulness. And thankfully for all of those who are in Christ, we know that we will not have to eternally and ultimately bear the penalty for our sinfulness. But sometimes God does cause us to suffer the consequences of our actions. And what Lamentations is saying to us is not that every pain that comes into your life is a result of your sinfulness. It does mean that sometimes God allows us to suffer the consequences, and when that happens, we can still go to him in the midst of our grief and our pain and our suffering. Like, notice, the author is clear, God, you did this, but the author is also clear about lamenting. And God is saying, this is right and good for you to turn to me. God isn't saying, look, you did this. This is a result of your actions. So don't go crying to me because you're suffering the consequences of what you did. No, God is honoring that and calling them to do that, which means when we make poor choices and our suffering is the result of that, it means we can still turn to God. Is your suffering the result of the fact that you've made some bad financial choices? Are you groaning under the weight of debt and financial mismanagement? You can still turn to God. Are you suffering because of poor health choices that you've made? You can still turn to God. And the reason that we can turn to God, and the reason the author of Lamentations says here in chapter 1 that it is right and good for us to turn to God in the midst of our pain and with our pain, it's because God and God alone can comfort. You see, a lament is built on faith. A lament is built upon what we believe about God. Your ability to go to God in the midst of your pain is going to be contingent upon what you believe about God. And so in Lamentations chapter 1, there is this a repetition of this phrase that there is no one to comfort me. In verse 2, there is no one to offer her comfort, no one from all her lovers. In verse 7, she had no one to help. In verse 9, there was no one to comfort her. In verse 16, for there is no one nearby to comfort me. Verse 17, there is no one to comfort her. Verse 21, but there is no one to comfort me. Over and over and over and over is the repetition of this theme. There is no one to offer comfort. The main theme of the chapter may be Jerusalem's misery, but the misery is made greater by the lack of human aid, of human companionship, of human kindness. They will neither deny their neediness or their pain. And there's an acknowledgement and the fact that only God can fulfill. Like the reason behind the repetition of there is no one to comfort, there is no one comfort, there is no one to comfort, is to remind the people, to remind the reader, that the things that we often turn to for comfort will ultimately fail us. There are idols in all of our lives. Things that we turn to for comfort, satisfaction, and joy and pleasure. And what happens in the midst of grief and pain is that we learn that those places that we often go to cannot ultimately comfort us. And that's why there's this repetition. What the people of Jerusalem are saying, what the people of Israel are saying, is that I turned to all these places for comfort, and in the midst of grief, in the midst of pain, there was no one there to comfort me. And it says it explicitly in verse 19, I called to my lovers, but they betrayed me. I called to my lovers, but they betrayed me. Now, the lovers here is this stand-in for sin, a stand-in for other idols, other gods that they are pursuing. What they're saying is, in the midst of our distress, we reached out to those things that we had given our hearts to and given our lives to, but they would not be there. They deceived me. And what the Bible says about sin is that sin is deceptive. Those things that we turn to for comfort and for peace and for happiness, they will always fail us. In John chapter 4, Jesus comes to a woman at a well. And he says to her, I am a water of life. If anyone drinks from this water, they will never thirst again. And she longs for that. She wants that. She wants to not be thirsty again. And she says to him, give me this water. And so he confronts her with the reality of what she's been turning to for pleasure. He talks to her about the many husbands that she's had. And this quick transition is this pointing out to her and to us as the reader that she'd been turning to these other things for satisfaction. But Jesus, the living water, is the one who will always satisfy. Like the woman, like Israel, we're tempted to think that other things will comfort us. We're tempted to think that other things will satisfy us. We're tempted to think finances will satisfy us. Tempted to think family will satisfy us. Tempted to think that physical pleasure will satisfy us. But what grief and pain and suffering display to us is that those things will not ultimately satisfy. That God alone can comfort. At all times, at every moment of our lives, if we turn to God for satisfaction, we'll be filled. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 through 5 says that God is the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all of our affliction. It means no matter what you're going through, God will comfort you. He can comfort you in the fact that you will never be separated from Him. for all of us, all who are in Christ, we learn in Romans chapter 8 that all of this pain, all of this discomfort is temporary, and none of it can separate us from the love of God. What we learn in Scripture is that Jesus came to display for us and to show us the righteousness and the love of God. And he says to the woman at the well, and he says to you and me, if anyone's thirsty, come. And what pain and suffering and grief teach us is that we're all thirsty and we all turn to constant other things, but none of them will satisfy us. And so we cry out to God. In the midst of our pain, with our pain, we cry out to God because God and God alone can comfort us. So I want to ask just a couple quick questions. And the first is, where are you going and where do you go with your pain? See, we all have reflexes. We all have habits, places that we turn in the midst of our pain. And my hope is that over the next few weeks, we learn to turn to God in the midst of our pain and turn to Him first. And one of the ways that we can learn to do that, learn to go to God in the midst of our pain and with our pain, is to begin this habit of writing out our laments. Maybe you need to take some time this week and to write out the things that are causing you pain. Write out what you're struggling to talk to God about. So the first question is where do you go with your pain? But the second and really most important question is, where do you go for comfort? Where are you looking to satisfy your soul and satisfy the longings of your heart? So what Lamentations 1 teaches us, and what all Scripture is teaching us, is that those lovers that we turn to are deceiving. They're deceptive. But God and God alone will comfort us. Jesus is looking at all of us and saying that He is the living water. He is offering freely to us. So, church, let us learn to lament together. Let us learn to cry out to God in the midst of our pain and suffering. And let's pray for one another. Pray that in the midst of our pain, in the midst of our grief, that we would all turn to God and not the things of this world. And one of the things that is going to happen at the end, after I conclude here, is there's a special song that Jeff and some of the members put together, which is a prayer over the people. It's called The Blessing. And we hope that you receive this song as a prayer from members of the church and a prayer from the church over you. A prayer that the Lord would bless you and keep you, make His face to shine upon you, and give you peace. In the midst of your pain, in the midst of your trial, your suffering, it's a prayer that God would be your comfort and your peace. Church, we miss you, and we look forward to being together again soon.
Shine upon you. on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turned his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.
Children, may his favor be upon you in a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children.
May his favor be upon you in a thousand generations, and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you, he is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming and your going, in your weeping and rejoicing. He is for you, he is for you, he is for you, he is for you.
Children and their children and their children.